For me, my story was I always was curious about nature and the world and how things worked around us, but I never really equated that to science. I was an athlete, football, basketball, track. I got the bare minimum grades so that I could continue playing. And so I didn't think that that panned into science, but I enjoyed the science classes I took when I went to college. Thought I wanted to be a medical doctor. And so I'm a big proponent, big fan of learning hands-on. So if you think you're interested in something, find an opportunity to go out and learn about it. I went and spent about 250 hours shadowing in a hospital and realized that saving lives is amazing, but the pressure of having someone's lives in your hands is not for me.
Okay. That's fair.
So I ended up, But I kept listening to TED Talks, which if you're familiar with those.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I love TED Talks. And one day I stumbled across one by a woman named Cynthia Kenyon about DAF2 mutations in C. elegans. I'll never forget it. But essentially, it was, everybody knows all of those words. Essentially what it was, though, was she had found a mutation that she could make in this worm's DNA that doubled its lifespan, which I thought was just crazy. So... is essentially like if the average human lived to be 50, you would live to be 100. But when you're 50 years old, you would feel and look like you're 25. And yeah, I thought that this was amazing. Like my young mind was like, okay, so making X-Men is real, is what she's telling me. How do I get into this?
I would want to be an X-Men.
Yeah, yeah. I was like, I wasn't here to save human lives. I was here to like give myself superpowers.
I like it. This story is my best story on the podcast so far now.
But yeah, so I went back to school. I was coaching at the time, so I went to a smaller school that was closer to me, Western Illinois University, which I have a lot of respect for there. That's where I became a scientist. I couldn't get into a lab that did genetics, and I happened to find one professor who had put up with a college dropout with low grades, Catherine Miller Hunt, who was studying mosquito viruses and manipulating the genetics of these mosquito viruses to understand when we would be at risk for getting things like chikungunya or dengue being spread here in the Midwest in the United States. And she essentially gave me a pipette and said, run free. And between her and another doctor, Dr. Andrea Porcel-Faro, who is doing fungal research, they both really encouraged me to just have free reign in the lab. And I loved what I was learning there. And as the time came for me to graduate, they were like, you know, you should look into doing a PhD. And I was like, I'm a poor kid from a single parent family. Like, I can't afford to do a PhD. And they're like, no. Biomedical PhD. They actually pay for you to go to school.
Wait, what?
I applied. Yeah. I get paid to do my job and to get a PhD. This is great. It's one of the best places to get a PhD.
Damn it.
Aside from the stress.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, I feel like a lot of people don't know this. I had no clue about this either. So biomedical PhDs, all schools paid for. So I go to Northwestern here in Chicago. And my schooling's paid for, insurance is covered, and they give us a stipend to live here, which is great. And then I get to do the science with nothing holding me back. So I applied to a couple schools, happened to get into a few of them. I chose to come here to Northwestern. And here, the cool thing about this program is it's an umbrella program. So a lot of times you have to choose, like as kids, I always tell you, you have to know what you want to do. Same for a grad program is you have to choose where you want to go. Mm-hmm. And then you find somebody who'll take you in. That wasn't the case here. I actually got to come in, kind of pick and choose a few different people I wanted to work with until I found the right fit for me. So I did some work with muscular disorders, studying a condition called spinal muscular atrophy. I worked in an HIV lab for a little bit, and I ended up choosing my lab, which I'm in now, where I study neuroinvasive viruses. So I study herpes viruses that get into your nervous system and into your brain.
Did you have to like what's the studying like for this? To do the work you do?
I mean, I've been in school forever. I think I'm in my like 23rd year of school.
Long time. You look very good for your age.
Thank you. Thank you very much. You know, I'm almost 30, pushing 30. Someday I'll have a real adult job, I guess.
Oh yeah. Don't do it. I'm telling you, it's not worth it.
it's a decent amount of study. At this point, it's all research. So I did, I guess 6 years if you take all of the time that I dropped out of school. So I did 3 years, then dropped out, and then did another 2.5 years of undergrad. So I got my degree in microbiology from Western eventually. So that was a lot of studying, a lot of learning about microbes and your general courses. And then once I came here, your first 2 years, you take classes. So you do a lot of biochemistry, cell biology. I took a lot of virology specific classes to learn about different types of viruses. And then at the end of all of this, there's this huge pressure moment where you do what's called a qualifying exam. And essentially you have to, our qualifying exam is you have to write your own grant, even though we've never had experience of this because I'm learning. And so you write this huge 10-page document where you come up with your own experiments to address a question. And then you have 3 full-blown PhDs who sit on a panel that you present to them, and they rip you apart. And if you survive, you come out on the other end, then you get to be a PhD candidate, we say. So it's kind of like being dubbed a knight. You don't have a PhD yet, but you have permission to do your research. And if you fail, then you get kicked out of the program. So very little pressure there.
Yeah, no pressure at all. And what would you say would be like the number of hours that you've put into this thing as a ballpark into being a virologist?
I can't even imagine.
Do you want to know the number?
Yeah. I think it would scare me. I used to, you can't see, I actually have like a little calendar that I broke things up by like quarters that I was here. And I used to actually track the number of hours that I worked, and then it became really depressing. I mean, I would say on average to get to this point, you could probably say on average, probably 60 hours a week times, I'm in my 4th year now. So you could do,
let's do this math here. 60 hours a week, 52 hours, 6 years, you said?
I'm in my 4th year in my PhD.
So that's
not including.
That alone is 12,480 hours.
Oh, perfect. So I've hit my 10,000 hour mark.
wow.
Malcolm Gladwell would be proud of me and my viral knowledge.
Yeah, absolutely. And so did you have to take any like high pressure tests, exams, anything while you were studying and learning?
So to get into grad school, you take what's called the GRE. And so it's kind of like the ACT or SATs that you take from high school to get into college. Mm-hmm. I'd also considered doing a dual MD PhD. So I took the MCAT as well, which is the medical version to get into med school.
Right.
And then you just do that qualifying exam, which is both the written and an oral exam to get to your candidacy position. So those 3 big ones, I guess.
Okay. And then now you're doing research in the lab.
Yeah.
Which is where you are now.
Exactly. I'm sitting at my desk in the lab. I'm actually showing my benchmate's desk because it's much cleaner than mine. I'm not an organized scientist.
I guess my first real big question for you then is, don't you feel kind of dumb doing all this work, 12,000 plus hours and all these tests and all these exams and everything, when you could have just gone on Google and learned everything you know now?